morning, everyone. Welcome to Live at Revision. Listen, we're so happy. We're so excited that you all decided to tune in for our pre-show. Listen, I'm excited for worship today. Truly, I believe God is going to do some amazing things. Listen, we want to see where you all are worshiping from. We know some of you all are here in person in the building, but some of you all are across the nation, across the globe. So we want to take a few moments just to shout you out. So go ahead, drop your name in the chat and drop your location and let us know where you are tuning in from. We are so excited that here at Revision, we have a broad community. We have those that live in Georgia, but we also have those who are Revisioners and they live outside of Georgia. And so we're so grateful that we have a broad community that worships with us. So go ahead, drop your name in the chat, drop your location, and let us know where you are worshiping with us from. All right, let's see who our Revisioners are today. I know we have some in Illinois and some in Arizona. You know, we even have some in Jamaica, some in Trinidad. All right, we said Dominique, good morning, Revisioner. Hey, how you doing? Good morning, good morning, good morning. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Who else do we have in the chat? Who else do we have? Who else do we have? Who else is worshiping with us? We got Kenny. Kenny's live and color at the media desk. What's going on, Kenny? Oh, man. Okay, worshiping and worship in Montreal, Canada. Okay, Montreal, Canada. Supposed to be going to Canada this year. Okay, Joy Shoemaker. Good morning, Sabbath blessings from beautiful, sunny, pleasant Illinois. Okay, sunny, pleasant Illinois. Awesome. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Who else do we have? Good morning from Florida. I love it. I love it. We have some Floridians in the building here today. Awesome. Who else do we have? Who else do we have? We got Florida, Ms. Shoemaker coming in from Illinois. I wonder what the temperature is looking like there in Illinois. FT Reed, good morning. Good morning. Awesome. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Awesome. Oh, listen, I see in the building we have one of our hosts, Christelle, who's going to be joining us. Okay. Listen, good morning, Pastor Houston Revision family. It's a beautiful here in Arizona. Okay. Okay. Rita in Arizona. Brandon Copeland. Okay. Watching from Silver Spring, Maryland. Silver Spring, Maryland. All right. Good stuff. Good stuff. Good stuff. Well, listen, we are so happy that you all are worshiping with us. Listen, we want to encourage you to connect with us on all of our platforms. We got a graphic that is about to go up. And so we encourage you to connect with us because we believe in connection here at Revision. We believe in connection. And so we want you to worship with us. You can worship with us on Instagram. You can worship with us on Facebook or even on YouTube. And so go ahead, worship with us. Awesome. What's going on, Christelle?
How's it going, Jordan?
I'm doing good. How you doing today?
Good.
Good, good. How's your week been?
Our week has been good.
It's been good.
It's been good. It's been busy.
Oh, I'm
sure a lot of us know that.
Yeah.
That's exactly why I want to talk about something this weekend. I want to know for everyone, what is your favorite way to bring in the Sabbath?
Favorite way to bring in the Sabbath. Okay.
What's your favorite way to bring in the Sabbath?
Ooh, this is a good question. Okay. So favorite way to bring in the Sabbath. I think I try to shut down everything by like 7:30, 8 o'clock if I can. And really, usually Chelsea and I, we usually like do like a check-in.
Yeah.
So we kind of like just talk about the week. Mm-hmm. And then we kind of just like ease, kind of just like slow into, just have a calm Friday night. Usually me and her end up doing some reading.
Yeah.
I usually end up doing some studying of some sort. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it's just usually like a very peaceful Friday night. Yeah, we usually have music going in the background.
Yeah.
It's just real calm and chill.
I like that.
Yeah. What about you?
What about me? So maybe it's a tradition. So growing up on Friday evenings, we always used to have family worship.
Okay.
And so sometimes when we have family worship again, it feels really nostalgic.
Yeah. Okay.
So I love like everybody just pausing and coming together and us having testimonies. We sometimes do like praise reports.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I think that's one of the ways that makes me feel centered again. And
okay.
Like at peace.
Yeah.
It's a good memory. Having family worship, it's a tradition we've always done. So
I love that. I love that. Awesome. Awesome. What about you all? What is your favorite way to bring in the Sabbath? I know every family has different family traditions.
Right, right.
Yeah. I know growing up, I used to read Uncle Arthur's bedtime stories.
I remember
Y'all remember those orange books?
Yeah. Listen. That is crazy.
Listen, those orange books are passed down generations in my family. Those were my dad's books.
They're old. I don't think they make them anymore.
No. And then there was a, it used to be, I used to have them on VHS.
The books?
No. They were these little videos. They were like Bible stories.
Really?
Yeah. They were like a Warner Brothers. Yeah. Warner like, Brothers. But they were Bible stories.
That's
yeah.
Great.
And they were about like these three kids. Mm-hmm. And they used to go back in time to like Bible like stories. And they used to like relive
that
them.
That's cool.
Yeah, it was really good. I forget the name of them.
It reminds me of Superbook. Which is one of the shows. They kind of redid Superbook. Have you ever heard of this?
Superbook? No, not Superbook.
It's about two kids, and they have this robot that their dad built for them, and they go back in time to like ancient times and learn about Bible stories.
Okay, I like that. That's very similar. See, best way to bring in a Sabbath is to settle down with family and worship together while giving thanks. I love that.
Freestyles, love it.
Dominique's light candles.
Lighting candles. That's peaceful. Yeah, I like that.
And praise with my favorite worship. Okay, song. Love that. Reese, get off work early dinner and reading and listening to SDA Vespers.
I would love to get off work early. Listen, I would love that life.
Listen, what? But here's the thing. Living here in Atlanta, you can get off work early, but that Friday traffic.
That it's terrible.
It's different.
See,
it's different.
That's a good one.
That's why I feel like everybody needs to work from home on Fridays.
I work from home on Fridays, which makes me feel like I work even later.
Oh,
because you know you're already home and you're like closing up all the things. So that's a good one. We need to really close that laptop.
Yeah, that's a good one. You got another question for us, Christelle?
I do.
Okay.
So we talked about favorite way to bring in the Sabbath. So what is your favorite part about the Sabbath? I think it might have been Rita's response about lighting candles, but one of my favorite things about the Sabbath is just the peace that it almost brings. It's like, you know, it's the Sabbath, and there's almost like this covering of peace that comes over. I feel the change. It's interesting. Yeah. I don't know what it is, but my favorite part is peace. I do like being like by myself at a certain part in the day and being very reflective.
Yeah.
So my favorite part is the peace.
The peace.
The solitude sometimes.
I like that. I think the simple fact that it's a 24 hours of pause, you know what I mean? Like, I'm not like worried about, I mean, coming to church, but it's like, I'm not worrying about running errands. You know what I mean? Like, I got Sunday to worry about that. You know what I mean? I just know after a long work week, that is 24 hours where I can just pause. I can reflect.
Right.
I can also worship and I can also fellowship with people.
And that means, hey, everything else, I like what you said about, you know, doing errands another day. It's like almost a given, like, this is the day.
Yeah.
I don't want to have to be bombarded.
Yeah.
I don't want to have to feel, you know, like, so many things are happening, multiple moving priorities. This is my beat.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I love that. What about you all? What's your favorite part of the Sabbath? What's your favorite? Timothy Jackson's Fellowship and Rest.
Fellowship and Rest. Okay. Yes.
Fellowship, rest and restoration.
Yes.
I love that.
All right, Miss Afri Styles says my favorite thing is fellowship with friends and Sabbath rest.
I like that. Okay, the fellowship in the community with others. I'm hearing fellowship a lot.
Fellowship.
Yeah, I love that. Rest from every work burden and even worry about the to-do list.
Yes.
To shift the mind.
That's what I'm saying. Like, don't even worry about it. Not even gonna think about that.
I like what she said, like a shift in mindset. You know what I mean? Like, it's just an opportunity to forget about your to-do list.
I love that one too. Well, here's one more for everyone. Speaking of the fellowship, and a lot of you said peace and rest, what does Sabbath rest mean to you? What is rest? What does Sabbath rest mean to you?
And
I think my answer is very similar to that to-do list, right? It means I don't have to worry about that today. It's almost like the get out of jail free card in a sense, right?
Yeah.
It's this piece that almost resonates and reminds me it's okay.
Yeah.
You don't have to conquer the world.
Yeah.
Today's not the day to do that.
Yeah.
God's gonna do it for you anyway. Okay.
Okay, Christine, for the preach.
I just like that. What about you, Pastor Houston?
I think two words. It's like rest and like reorientation. So I think like Sabbath is an opportunity for me to rest, meaning like just resting in God, you know, but also like reorienting. Like I think sometimes, I think because of the busyness of the week and the to-do list, you know, you can become like disoriented.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Kind of all over the place.
Yeah.
And so oftentimes I find through worship, through fellowship, that I'm able to reorient and get almost kind of like in realignment.
Yeah.
You know?
It's like a pause and a reset.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. I like that.
What about everyone else? What does Sabbath rest mean to you?
Yeah. What does it mean to you? What does it mean to you? Timothy Jackson says restoration and a fresh start. I like that. I like that.
All right. It says to me, it means stop, rest, and reflect.
I like that. Mm-hmm. Stop, rest, and reflect. Okay. Dominique says, rest of mind. Whatever is not done, I don't feel guilty. It will wait.
There you go. There you go.
Yeah. Yeah.
Leo says, to me, it means God has my back and to lean on him.
Oh, I like that. Hey, Leo.
Take it down a deeper a notch. I like that.
Yeah. Hashtag reorientation.
I love it.
Love it. Awesome. Awesome. Well, listen, today we hope that you find joy in the Sabbath.
Yes.
Joy, rest, reorientation, whatever it is that you love about the Sabbath, we hope that you experience that today. Listen, God has been moving in our community. We have so many things that's going on in our community, and we want to take an opportunity to share some of those things with you. And so the first thing is that, listen, it's April. I can't believe it's April already.
I'm still trying to catch
up. We're in the second quarter already of the year. Mm-hmm. Next month is graduation season.
Oh, my goodness.
We got high school graduations, mm-hmm. middle school graduations, kindergarten graduations, college graduations. And so whether you are graduated from high school, college, or with a PhD, we want to celebrate you. Let us know you're graduating by filling out the quick survey. So we encourage you to go ahead and scan this. And we want you to include your name, your school, your completion level, and a phone number. And we also want to take a photo of you. So on April 13th today, and also next week, we'll be here taking photos. And then this also applies if you are a revisioneer. So if you are a revisioneer, let us know. Let us know there if you are like not here in Georgia, and you can send in a photo for us. All right. We want to celebrate you all in the month of May. Graduating is a major accomplishment.
Yes.
So we want to celebrate you all.
Congrats. That's amazing. Yeah. And Jordan, there's something else coming up in May.
Something else coming up. And we want to actually invite Lauren Reynolds to come on. It's Beat the Buzzer. Okay. Beat the Buzzer. And she's going to tell us a little bit more about that.
Are you guys ready for Beat the Buzzer?
Yeah.
All right, Revision Church, next Sabbath, April 20th at 7 p.m., we are having our Beat the Buzzer Game Championship event. So bring your friends, bring your family. We have a whole bunch of spaces for teams. And so if you love Wallin' Out and you love Minute to Win It, you're going to love Beat the Buzzer. It's a great combination. We're going to have really fun games, chances to win prizes.
Yeah.
So come on out and have a great time with us next Sabbath. We look forward to seeing everybody there. And there's still opportunities to sign up. So keep an eye out. The church will be sending out another text message. So you can have the link to sign up, or you can just go to Eventbrite and look for Beat the Buzzer or look for our events under Revision. So we look forward to seeing everybody there.
I love that. And for Beat the Buzzer, tell us a little bit about, who is this for? What ages can participate?
So we're looking at ages 13 and up for the Beat the Buzzer Championship event, but we also have a party for our little ones that are under 13. So it's for all ages.
I love this. I love this. And what should everyone expect at Beat the Buzzer? What kind of questions are they going to be asking? What kind of trivia?
So it won't be trivia. These are going to be talent kind of games. So there'll be games where you're going to compete against other teams for there'll be timed events.
Mm-hmm.
You'll have to do impromptu stuff like that. So I'm hoping everyone gets their creativity ready where I'm giving you different props, and you're going to have to do some cool things with those props. Mm-hmm. And the person that can do the best one is going to win.
No pressure.
It's going to be silly and funny. I hope you got your vocal folds ready, because You're going to be singing some songs. You're going to be making up some stuff. You're going to really having a good time. We got bubbles. We got props. We got candy. We got all kinds of stuff. So I hope that that gives people and makes them excited, but doesn't give things away just yet.
Oh, I love that. Well, thank you, Lauren. That sounds like an exciting time. We appreciate you sharing that. And also for everybody out there who gets another opportunity to fellowship. So Saturday, April 20th,
yes,
we look forward to seeing everyone there ages 13 and up. Scan the QR code on the screen right now if you'd like to participate, if you'd like to register. Sounds like it's going to be totally fun. Lots of team fun, interaction. We'll see you all there on April 20th.
Awesome, awesome. I'm excited about that.
Me too. Yeah, that sounds crazy.
Listen,
that sounds cool.
She said, wilding out?
Yeah. Okay.
Listen, listen, I'm excited about Beat the Buzzard. Listen, we also have something that's going on today.
Yeah.
All right, today. And we want to invite our social justice leader to come and be a part and tell us a little bit about what's going on. We're going to have a symposium after church, preparing for the primaries. What you need to know for the 2024 elections. All right. And so this is happening in person here today, and it's actually going to be virtual. So, Gabriel Carter, our social justice leader, is here. Yes, how you doing, my friend?
I'm doing good, man. I'm excited for today. It's going to be a good day.
Okay, so, Gabe, tell us first and foremost, before we get into the event, all right, you're our social justice leader.
Yeah.
So, tell us a little bit about what is it that your ministry does?
So, a lot of churches with really, really good intentions do a lot of community service. They feed people in need. Mm. They help, you know, provide clothes for people who may not have clothes.
Okay.
We do those things, too, but... Yeah. We also want to tap into social justice, meaning we want to get rid of those systems that cause people to be vulnerable, cause people to be oppressed, and all that stuff, man. So we're fighting against the system, man. Yeah. And one of the ways you could do that is through your vote. So excited to tap into that today.
Okay, awesome, awesome. So, social justice leader, do you have a team?
Yeah, we got a team of good folks around us. My assistant leader is Norsla. She's just great. She's hopefully you get her into the camera one of these days and just let you get to meet her. But if you come today, you'll get a chance to meet her. And we're building out the rest of our team. So one of the things we're going to talk about today is how you can be a part. So we're going to talk about, we're going to have an orientation meeting next month. So if you want to be a part, or if you signed up, or if you reached out to us, please come next month. We'll make sure you have those dates as soon as possible. Be able to come and sign up and, you know, be a part of the team.
Awesome. I love that. I love that. So listen, you all. They're doing some recruitment, it sounds like, so social justice team. So if you're interested, it seems like, one, you can tune in today. So if you're a revisionaire or if you're in person, we encourage you to come out today. Or we also have a place on our website. If you go to our website, to our crew page, all of our revision crews, you can go to the social justice section and you can sign up to find out more information from our social justice team there as well. So, Gabe, tell us a little bit about what's happening today.
So today we're focusing on the primaries. As some of you may know, the primaries are coming up in May. So what that means is that if you're voting on a Democratic ballot, you're going to pick who you want to represent that Democratic ticket. There may be several candidates, but you're going to pick who's the one person from the Democrat ticket, or if you're Republican, the Republican ticket, who's going to represent that position. And then in a general election, that's when we decide between those two candidates, one for Democrat, one for Republican. So we're going to be talking today about the primaries coming up in May. How do you get registered to vote? How do you request an absentee ballot? All the information you know, we're going to be covering that today at 2 o'clock in our revision in the reception hall.
Okay, in the reception hall. So we're going to cover our... And so are you going to be doing the speaking, or who's going to be speaking?
So we have somebody named Caroline Ramos, who's going to be coming here. She's a, you know, voting education expert. Okay. She, you know, does this stuff. She speaks to different places and congregations and stuff like that. So I'm really excited for you all to get a chance to meet her.
Awesome.
Tons of information. She's worked at almost every level of government, kind of working on this stuff. So I'm excited for you to get a chance to tap in and hear what she has to say. So I'm excited.
Awesome. Awesome. Listen, I'm excited for this as well. So for those of our revisionaires that are watching, is there an opportunity for them to participate and watch this as well?
Absolutely. We're going to be streaming this. So after you get done watching church, make sure you don't, you know, close your laptop or turn off your TV too quick. Stay around at 2 o'clock. We're going to be streaming this event. We wish you could be here in person. I know some of you are out of the state. So and this is key. For some of you, we'll actually be covering some of the key states in which we have a large number of revisionaries. So North Carolina, Washington D.C. area, just a lot of different states that you all may be a part of. So you definitely want to tune in to make sure you can get some information.
I love that. Listen, Gabe, we really appreciate you coming on, sharing about what's happening today with the symposium. I'm looking forward to it.
Absolutely.
So again, for all of our revisionaires, remember, there is an opportunity for you to tune in and watch this as well. As Gabe has shared, listen, there are some critical states. And so you may live in one of those critical states. So this is for you as well. So you can know maybe how to register. Maybe you're saying, I might be traveling during the election season, so I need to fill out an absentee ballot. Listen, again, this is for you. So we encourage you to tune in at 2. So it's at 2, y'all. So you guys got a little small window to go ahead and get some food if you need to in your system. All right. Or you can even eat during the symposium too. So you can get your food ready and then you can be able to tune in to the symposium at 2:00. And if you're here in person, listen, there's also food after church. All right. So you don't got to go nowhere. You ain't got to run down to Pont City Market and get some food and then try to come back. No. There's food right here on site. So you can stay by and then we can transition right into the symposium in the fellowship hall on the first floor, right down the hallway at 2:00.
I love that. Yeah. Well, I kind of want to talk a little bit more about that, Pastor Beast, about the election.
Yeah.
Because I'm sure a lot of us have questions about it. Sometimes we all also think we only vote once, and that's at the presidential election that happens every 4 years.
Absolutely.
But I want to do, can we do trivia? Maybe our own version of Beat the Buzzer?
Yeah, let's do this. Okay, we're about to wild out.
Okay. Oh my gosh. Well, Pastor, who's it? I have a question for you.
Okay.
What is a vote cast by someone who is unable to show up in person, you know, or they're unwilling to go to the official polling station, which is, you know, which the voter is normally allocated?
Okay.
So what do you call a vote cast by someone
who
doesn't show up to the actual polling station?
What do you call the vote? This is interesting. I want to hear some responses before I make a guess.
Okay.
All right. What is a vote cast by someone who is unable or unwilling?
Right.
To go to the polling stations.
And you guys have 10 seconds. This is Beat the Buzzer in a sense.
Okay.
So chat, write in your answers as fast as possible before Jordan gives us the true answer.
All right. Y'all got 3 seconds. All right. Okay.
Any answers?
What we looking like? Okay. Absentee ballot. Yes, absolutely. It's an absentee ballot. Good job.
That was a good one.
Absentee ballot. So yes, you can fill out an absentee ballot if you feel like, hey, I might be traveling during this time, or maybe you don't want to go to the polling station, so you can mail in your absentee ballot. And you can vote that way.
There are options out there. Okay, here's another one. What is the deadline to vote in the general election on November 5th?
Okay.
So the deadline to vote in the general election that we all are usually familiar with.
Okay.
Your time starts now, right?
The deadline to vote. All right.
And this one is new. I didn't know this one myself either.
Yeah. I didn't know this one either.
So no shame if everybody doesn't know.
Okay.
We're going to tell you.
So it's November 5th.
Uh-huh.
So I'm thinking 2 weeks, 3 weeks.
Okay. Before November.
Before November 5th.
Okay.
2 or 3 weeks before November 5th. All right.
Let's see if you're right, Pastor Jordan.
Okay.
Looks like some people want to know too.
So some people want to know too. Okay.
Okay.
The answer is October 7th. Okay.
October 7th.
So we still have some time. We're in April. So you have time to register. Awesome. We have another one?
We have another one.
Okay.
Okay. So true or false this time?
Okay.
You need to provide a reason to request an absentee ballot by mail. True or false? You need to provide
a reason
to request that absentee ballot. True or false?
In other words, I need to tell them
why you can't show up.
Why I can't show up. I need to tell them that I might be on vacation. All right. True or false?
What do you all think?
Yeah, we want to hear from you all in the chat. What are you all thinking? True or false on this one? True or false?
Is it true? Timothy Jackson says true.
True. Okay. You have to provide a reason. All right.
You have to provide a reason.
He said, if you got a crazy work schedule, you can't make it, you need to provide that reason.
I have to let them know.
I got to let them know. Kenny says false.
Okay.
You got to provide no reason.
That's my business.
Yeah, that's my business.
Okay.
you don't even know what I'm doing. Sharon says false. Okay. Okay.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, okay, what do you think? What's the true answer?
The true answer is false. Mm. Absentee voting is available and no excuse is required. You can return your absentee ballot request form through the mail or in person.
Wow.
Yeah.
So they don't even have to know why you didn't show up or why you can't show up.
Yeah.
So there's, once again, more reason why you should vote, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. Yeah, okay. That's your business.
That's your business.
That's your business.
Well, here's one more thing that I learned too, right?
Yeah.
So once again, we all usually talk a lot about the general election that happens in November. Mm-hmm. But did you know, while presidential elections often receive the most attention, local elections for officers and offices such as your mayor, city council, so on and so forth, can significantly impact your community, as I'm sure you all may know. So do you know when the next local election is?
Ooh, the next one.
The next one. And here's the hint. It's coming up soon.
The next local election.
Mm-hmm. And you probably drive through your local communities and see signs.
Signs. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. I know where we live. We always have signs.
Right.
Oh, my goodness. They're everywhere. Everywhere.
Anyone know? If you don't know, that's okay. You think we should tell them now, Jordan?
I think we should tell them.
Okay.
Let them know.
The next one is Tuesday, May 21st. That's next month.
Okay.
That's
okay.
Next month.
That's a general primary nonpartisan election.
Exactly.
Awesome. 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 Well, listen, Crystal, I appreciate you taking us through these trivia questions. These are valuable facts that we need to know. And I'm excited because we're going to learn more about this afternoon at 2 o'clock. So we encourage you all to tune in for that symposium on what you need to know about voting for the upcoming elections. Listen, I'm excited for worship today.
Yes.
I know we're going to be starting a new sermon series today. And so, Revision Church family, we encourage you, let's worship today. Listen, even if you are a revisionary, you're at home, maybe you're a family member's house, hey, you might be even in the car. We encourage you, be safe, but let's worship together, family, today in spirit and in truth. We'll see you in worship.
Welcome to church. We gather to worship an amazing God who created the heavens, the earth, all that lives, crucified, buried, risen, holy. Jesus is good. Jesus is forever. You are loved. You are accepted. You belong. Welcome to Revision Church.
Revision Church family, are you happy to be here today? Happy to be alive? Happy to be in the house of the Lord? Come on, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we are set in our minds. We are set in our hearts to rejoice and to be glad in it. Oh, taste and see that the Lord, He is good this morning. Amen. And if you stand witness to that, if you bear witness to that this morning, why don't you pop up on your feet this morning? Lord, you are the Lord of the harvest. Amen.
You.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. God is our daily bread, our present help.
Yes, he is.
He is everything. And I'm just so glad that we are able to celebrate God. And we're able to celebrate God together. Amen.
Amen, amen. The Bible says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving.
Yes.
And into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him. Bless his name, for the Lord is good.
Mm-hmm.
His mercy is everlasting.
Come on.
And his truth endures to all generations. So we are so glad that you are with us today, whether you're with us here in person or online, whether you're watching, rewatching, you are in the right place. That's because Revision Church Atlanta is a church that exists to reintroduce Jesus to the city of Atlanta.
Yes.
By leveraging the power of prayer, personal influence, community development, and love to bring about transformation in our lives. And so we're just so grateful to be here with you today.
Yes, yes. And Pastor Tiffany, we have a lot going on here.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about what's going on at Revision?
Absolutely. I'm really excited for today. We have a lot going on. So here at Revision, every second Saturday of the month, we do something special to engage in our community. So we want to invite you to stay after, or if you're watching, you can watch after, right after church. We're going to be right next door in the reception hall or community cafeteria. And we will be learning about how to prepare for the primaries that's coming up in just a few weeks. So we want to invite you to be a part of that. We have a special guest, Caroline Ramos. She's going to be helping us with being educated in voting. How many of you guys need to learn a little bit more about voting, like me? All right, six of us. All right, we're going to be there, but we want to invite you to join us, and we're going to have food. So at least stay by and eat with us.
I think you need to repeat that again. We're going to have food.
We're going to have food.
So you don't need to rush home. You can just join us. We're going to have food. We're going to talk, chat, and learn. So we hope every single one of you will be there, and those online, that you will join us too.
Absolutely. Also, immediately after church today, we're going to be taking pictures of our graduates.
Yes.
So, yes.
I think that needs applause.
Class yes. of 2024. We want to invite you to stay, and you're going to be taking pictures in room 205. So if you go right down the hall, it's the fourth door on the right. And just show up. We have props for you, little things to celebrate 2024. So stay with us. I know a lot of people have already signed up, Pastor Gina.
That is great. Mm-hmm. That is great.
Some folks graduating from college, high school.
Amen.
Middle
amen.
School?
Mm-hmm.
Middle school.
Middle school.
Did you graduate from middle school?
Yes, we had a graduation.
Oh, really?
Uh-huh. Did you not? Okay.
We had like a stepping up program. We didn't have like a cap and gown, but it seems like there's almost graduation for like every level, which is cool.
Yeah, even preschool, pre-K, there's graduation. So we're just happy to celebrate That's, everyone.
Celebrate. That's the point. We're celebrating. We're celebrating. Hey, next Sabbath, we're going to be playing together. So we not only like to worship together, learn together, but we also want to play together. So join us next Saturday evening. We're going to start off with a Vespers at 7:30. And then at 8 o'clock, we're going to jump into our games called Beat the Buzzer. So even if you see that the sign-up has closed, we want to invite you to still come out and play with us. So we'll have age 13 and up upstairs and the little ones downstairs. We're going to have something for everybody. So come out and play with us next Saturday night.
And I'm really excited for that because my competitive side can come out.
Okay.
I know a lot of people have that competitive side. They like to keep on the down low, but this is the time to let it out.
Yeah.
Because there's some good prizes, I hear.
Okay.
There's some really good prizes. So
I don't know if I've seen your competitive side.
You don't want to see it.
No.
No, it's all fun and games, but okay. I love to play.
All right, I'm gonna get to see a new side of you, Pastor Gina. Well, we also want to invite you to stay tonight, to join us tonight at 6 p.m. for our virtual business meeting. So if you're a member of Revision Church Atlanta, jump online at 6 o'clock p.m. We'll be sending out the link to you so you can jump on and be a part of our virtual business meeting. You'll be learning a little bit about where we are in our process for getting our own building. And we would like you to be a part of that meeting tonight at 6 p.m. And today, we are also recognizing that it is Sexual Assault and Prevention Awareness Month.
Yes.
That is something that is sometimes not really talked about or thought about. But if this is something that has affected you in your life, we just want to put that number on the screen where you can call or text 1-800-656-4673. If you yourself or you know someone who has experienced sexual assault, if we could just keep that number on the screen, that's something that's really important to be able to have a voice to that and to share what we've experienced.
And I love that this month we're focusing on awareness, because not many people know that men deal with sexual assault as well.
That's right.
Many times we hear the stories of the women, but there's also men who experience it. So once that number comes on the screen, if you know anyone or you of yourself have experienced any type of assault, reach out. Get some help. There is help for you, and there's people who care, and we care here at Revision. So that's why we want to share that resource with you.
Right.
And even now, we want to enter into prayer for those who have experienced any type of assault, any type of violence at the hands of a loved one, a friend, a caregiver, even just a stranger. We want to enter into a time of prayer. So now we just ask that if you could just think of someone. Think of someone you may know that may have experienced any type of violence. And if you don't know anyone, just offer up a simple, vague prayer for those who are victims of sexual assault. So can we do that? Just take some time to pray wherever you are in your heart, wherever you are, and just think of a victim. Lift up a prayer for them. Or if you don't know anyone, just in general, pray for the victims in Atlanta especially. There's a high rate of sexual assault in this city. It just takes some time to pray for them. For we are a community and we want to pray for everyone. So feel free to do so, and then I'll pray afterwards. God, we thank you that we can take some time today to bask in your presence and silence and lift up prayers for those who have been victims of sexual assault and other types of violence. God, we know that you are a God that is ever present,
yes.
That you care, that you see, that you even feel the pain that we feel. So God, we are thankful that you are a God that is present with victims.
Jesus.
We are thankful you are a God that stands with victims and cares and loves for victims. God, you don't give any shame. You don't have any guilt, pass out any guilt, but you bring about freedom and healing for all. So God, in this space, if there's anyone here today that has been struggling with any type of assault or violence, God, we pray and we declare that you are a God of healing.
Yes.
You are a God of protection, and you are a God of safety for them. It is possible for them, and it will be theirs, for you are with them. And you are with all of us, God, even if we don't know of anyone in this space. God, we pray for all victims in Atlanta, God, that you would cover our city so that violence will not prevail, that hurt will not prevail, and that enemy, the things he wants to do in this city, will not prevail in the name of Jesus.
Yes,
this will be a city that declares your goodness, that shows your love, that gives and doesn't hurt, that gives and doesn't take away. And Revision Church Atlanta will be that beacon that gives and do so in this community, God. We need you so much, Father.
Yes, Lord.
We need you. You see your children hurting. Even if it's not physical violence, Lord, there is emotional hurt many are going through. Even spiritual, God. And we declare and we believe that you would bring about healing by the power of your spirit. So wherever people are today, spiritually, emotionally, even those online, wherever they are, God, we are so thankful that you are just near and you are here. So in your presence today, God, we pray that we will receive healing, but also be able to praise you in a different way. That we will to say hallelujah despite everything. That we will declare that victory is ours and healing and victory is on the way. Yes, so God, we thank you for all that you're about to do now. We thank you for how you show up in our lives.
Thank you, Lord.
We thank you for the transformation that you bring, God.
Yes.
We thank you.
Mm-hmm.
And we pray all of this in the name of Jesus, and all believers say
amen
and amen.
Amen, amen, amen. We just want to thank the Lord for what he is doing. Do you believe that he's doing something today?
Yes.
You believe the Lord. Let's just go ahead and give him a praise. Yes. And we just want to invite up our clerk as we are celebrating what God is doing. God is adding to his church day by day. And today we want to invite up our clerk, Jessica Cook. Can you guys just give her a little welcome? Jessica's going to read off who is going to be joining us as our first reading today.
Good morning. This is the first reading, April 13, 2024. Transferring from Revision to Peachtree Hills SDA Church of Noonan, Keith Fowler II. Transferring into Revision from Augusta First SDA Church in Augusta, Georgia, Sheldon Blair. From Emmanuel Brinklow Adventist Church in Aston, Maryland, Charles Reynolds II. From Elam French Haitian SDA Church in Naples, Florida, Kimberly Harard. From Corona SDA Church in Corona, New York, Doran Antoine. And by profession of faith, Stacy Piper.
Amen, amen. Let's give those a hand clap. I know some of those names have been waiting for a minute. And so we are grateful for what God is doing. We just like to invite you to stand with us as we continue to praise the Lord today in song.
All right, Revision, I think she says stand up, but maybe it's the opposite of sit down. I don't know, First Lady, which is it? Now I'm a teacher now, so stand on up. Get up on them feet, y'all. Amen. Let's make the Lord's name glorious this afternoon in his presence. This is a new song, so we want you all to join in. We welcome you to join in. The lyric is on the monitor. So enjoy the Lord this morning singing this song with us, all right?
Glorious, shout it out and glorious, make it loud. Jesus, we shout your name. Jesus, we make your praise. Glorious, you are glorious.
How great your name, your love,
remains forever and ever. You say the same.
Shout it out, shout it out, shout it out, shout it out. If you know he's good, sing it out, sing it out. If the Lord is good, shout it out.
Your mercies are new every morning. Your grace, where would we be? Where would you be? Where would I be if it was not for the grace of God? If it had not been for you, oh Lord, I don't know where. But I'm so grateful for your grace. I'm so grateful for your mercy that shows up and sprinkles into my life every single morning. You promised that, God. You said it in your word. New mercies I see. So just think about it with the song.
Where would I be if not for your grace carrying me in every sea? It was.
God's grace today. Put your hands together. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Just keep playing that right up under me. We think of the goodness of God and all that he's done for us. Oh, we give him the glory today. How many of you just glad to be alive today, see another day? The mercies of the Lord met you this morning. So we are grateful to be in this place. Hallelujah, hallelujah. God is good. God is worthy to be praised. Don't start me. Yeah, thinking about the goodness of Jesus. How many of you know that song? Come on, praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Oh, yes, praise him. Praise him. Hallelujah. Praise him. Yes, praise him. Oh, I hear you, Jesus. Blessed Savior, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be. We're still waiting on some of y'all to join us. Come on, praise him, praise him, praise. Oh, yes, come on and praise. Oh, yes, we give him the glory, praise. Oh, yes, oh, praise. Oh, Jesus. Blessed Savior, he's worthy to. Come on, let's do that. From the rising of the sun, from the rising of the sun, until the going down of the same. Hallelujah, he's worthy. I hear you. Jesus is worthy. He's worthy to be. Yes. That's why we've come in here to praise. Yes. Come on and praise him. Hallelujah. Praise. That's why we came to church today. Praise. That's why you logged on today. Jesus. Blessed Savior. He's worthy to be praised. Come on. There's another verse that says, God is my rock. If he's your rock, stand to your feet. God is. That means I can depend on him. Yes, hope. Hope of salvation. He's a strong deliverer. I hear you, church. In him will I always trust? And so we shall glory, glory, yes. Give him the glory, yeah, in all things. Give him glory, give him glory. Jesus, blessed Savior, blessed Savior, hallelujah. God, we thank you today. Everyone standing as we get ready to read the scripture for today. Thank you to our praise team. Thank you and to our musicians for rendering their honorable service today. We stand not only in honor of God's word, but we stand to draw our attention to this moment as God speaks to us. We are excited about what God is about to say today. And I have to let you know, I was personally challenged to preach this word, really in a sense to teach it rather than preach it, as we share with you what God has to say about giving, about generosity, about faithfulness to God in our finances. Now, somebody's saying, oh, Lord, I came to church on the wrong day. Pastor gonna talk about money. But you do know that God is serious, takes very seriously what he's entrusted to us. And so today I want to share with you, teach some principles, and then really open up and share with you what we at Revision Church believe God has called us to do with the funds that you have entrusted to us. And so I want you to turn to Genesis chapter 4. And in Genesis chapter 4, you can turn on your devices. We also have it on the screen for those who don't are not able to get that. Genesis is the first book of the Bible. The Old Testament tells the origin of humanity. And in Genesis chapter 4, I'm going to read in your hearing verses 1 through 5. 1 through 5 from the English Standard Version here in Genesis 4. If you're ready, shout yes. If you're ready in the chat, just drop yes in the chat. Here's the word of the Lord. Now Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain, saying, I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord. And again she bore his brother Abel. Now Abel was a keeper of sheep, and Cain a worker of the ground. In the course of time, Cain brought to the Lord an offering of the fruit of the ground. And Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering. But for Cain and his offering, he had no regard. So Cain was very angry, and his face fell. I want to point your attention back to verse 3 and 4. In the course of time, Cain brought to the Lord an offering of the fruit of the ground, and Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering. Today I want to teach from the subject, why you give. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, pastor's going to tell you why you ought to give. All right, let's pray. God, in your power and in your might, speak to us that we might know your will. Make us not just hearers of your word today, but doers of your word. So speak. We are not only informed, but transformed by the renewing of our minds. In Jesus' name, let everyone say amen. Amen. You may be seated. I want to admit to you that as lead pastor of this great community, this great church, I have been somewhat derelict in my duty and have overlooked and perhaps underappreciated a part of my responsibility to teach you about giving and faithfulness to God. I mean, we've preached several types of series ranging from all types of topics from Old and New Testament, rooting these principles and these statutes coming from the Word of God, trying to make it practical and relevant. And yet, I think I've only really preached on giving maybe once or twice in the whole time of our gathering together. I have to be honest, I've not preached about giving because if I just be transparent, I don't want to fall into the prevailing caricature of black preachers and black churches that are always begging for money. Some of you have come from other faith traditions or other churches or denominations, and whether it be denominational or non-denom, there are some places where they get up and they guilt you into giving. Do I have a witness? Shame you into giving, or give you these empty promises that if you just sow this, and it's interesting how they give you a particular amount, right? that if you sow this $1,000 seed, you'll get 1,000 times blessing. And this has been really a misappropriation of the word of God as it relates to giving. It's been malpractice, if you will, of the church that has oftentimes twisted scriptures to make them say things that they don't say, or sometimes they don't even root their appeals for giving in the word. It's just simply guilt, shame, or empty promises. But another reason why, so I didn't want to fall into that category, but another reason why is because I think I perhaps naively assumed that people knew why they needed to give. That, you know, even if you've been here for a little while, you've heard us kind of explain in brief fashion what it is that we do and how you support the ministry financially allows us to do all these things. But today I want to teach a principle, and then I'm going to show you some data from our giving at the church so that you can understand why it is that you give. I think it's important for you to know, because giving is not simply a financial contribution to the church. Giving is a spiritual practice of trust in the God who gave you the money you already have. Amen, somebody. So I want to start off in Genesis 4, because I think it's important for us to understand that giving, this practice of giving in the church, the practice of faithfulness to God in our finances, this practice of tithing and offering and all the different forms of what we give to God, this practice of donating to the church, not just your time and talent, but your treasure, actually begins in the very beginning. And for many of us, we don't understand that Genesis actually gives us the first understanding of what giving is really all about and why you should give. You just read in Genesis chapter 4, Adam and Eve come together and they give birth to a son named Cain. And then they have a son named Abel. And the Bible says that in the course of time, I like the way it says that, in the course of time, verse 3, Cain brought to the Lord an offering. Now, here's something that I want you to understand. Cain brings this offering, and this offering that he brings to God, it is before, it precedes any command of God. It's important to note this. You'll see where I'm going in a minute. That Cain does not give. Nowhere in Genesis 1 through 3 do you see that God commands an offering. There is no bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse. There is no scripture or principle that calls for Cain to give the offering. It says in the course of time, Cain of his own volition comes to the realization that he needs to give an offering. Don't miss the powerful principle here. Most of us, most people who give in church, give either out of spiritual obligation, out of the fact that they've been trained to give, the fact that perhaps they are Bible students and they read in the Word that it says that God loves a cheerful giver. So whether it be by command or by tradition or by training or indoctrination or reading the Word, for all these myriad of reasons, people give. But Cain, God is showing us in Cain's situation and Abel's situation that they were not given any command by God. There's no scripture. There's no Bible, right? We are reading what they are going through. There is no Hebrew Bible. They have no scripture, no Bible to pick up to tell them what to do. The Bible says in the course of time, they gave an offering. This means that the primary reason why we give should not be because the word tells us to give. Now, I just lost some of you. I'm not against the word. I'm going to show you in a minute. But remember, Cain doesn't have a Bible. There's no command from God, from heaven, that you read about in Genesis 1, 2, or 3 to tell him to give. Y'all see where I'm going? Cain doesn't have the Bible to tell him. Cain doesn't have people shaming him, guilting him, or blaming him. Cain gives in the course of time, it says. Cain comes to a realization. What realization? I'm glad you asked. Cain realized without a Bible, Cain realized without God giving him a command that God's very nature is to give. And if God's very nature is to give, then I ought to reflect his nature and give. Oh, you just missed your shout cue. See, our problem is that we wait for some kind of biblical obligation to give. We wait for some command. Some of us even give out of fear. You remember when they would read Malachi 3 and they would only quote and put emphasis on one part of it. Will a man rob God? He have robbed me, both tithes and offerings, right? You are cursed with a curse. And boy, the elders would just lean into that one. You are cursed with a curse. And so you fork over the money because you don't want to be cursed. But what I'm trying to teach you is the biblical principle, the very first recording of any offering given to Yahweh in human history comes from someone who doesn't have a Bible. Ain't no elder guilting them, nobody reading from the scripture to twist and manipulate and make them feel bad. The Bible says, in the course of time, he realized in the course of time that God's nature is to give. And as he's tilling the ground, he realizes the only reason this ground is giving me back some vegetables, it's yielding something that we can eat, is because God gives. First principle, if you write this down today, if you're taking mental note, is that the reason you give is not because the church needs it. That's not the primary reason. The reason you give is not because the Bible says so. The reason you give primarily is because God gives to you. God gives to humanity the breath of life. Then God turns around and after he's created Adam, gives Adam Eve, who is his equal partner in humanity, made in the image of God. And then after sin, even though they disobeyed God, they find themselves realizing that they are naked and they are ashamed. God gives them a covering. And then as you go down through history, God keeps giving his people blessings that they don't deserve. Children of Israel in the wilderness, after being liberated from Egyptian slavery, are now dealing with the throes of not having all the bread and all the resources that they need. And God gives them this bread that falls from heaven. They call it manna, meaning, what is it? I don't even know what it is. I just know God provided. And some of you have had manna, right? Where God gave you blessings, you didn't know where it came from. You didn't understand how where it came from. You didn't know how God knew the timing, but you just thank God that he sent it right on time. The reason why we give, hear me, church, is we give because God is a giver. We don't give just because the Bible says so. Yes, the Bible does. We don't give just because the church needs the funds to be able to do ministry. Yes, that's good. But the primary thing you need to understand is the God you serve, Yahweh, is a giver. And every believer in God must reflect his character and be a giver. If you're still with me, shout yes. Now, here's the thing. I told you Cain and Abel, in the course of time, Adam and Eve didn't tell them. They weren't instructed on it. It is interesting to note that Adam and Eve are not recorded giving an offering. It's this second generation that gives it. In the course of time, Cain and Abel give an offering, but your Bible says that Cain gives from what he's over, what he's familiar with. He would till the ground. He would pick up the vegetables. He would sow the seed. He would reap a harvest. So when he gives an offering, he gives from the ground. When Abel, who is a herdsman, gives an offering, he gives a lamb. Now, it's interesting to note that they both give an offering, and they both give what they have, but only one is accepted. Now, they both give what they have, and I want you to understand there's no problem with what Cain, it's not that he gave vegetables to God that was an issue. Because remember, this predates the sanctuary service. There is no Bible to tell them that they need to give a lamb instead of fruit or vegetables. Don't miss this. The reason why Cain's offering was not favored like Abel is because Cain gave what was left over. Now it's going to get real quiet in here, Richardson. Pray for me. It was, watch this, a lack of faith in the God who had blessed him with the harvest that he gave God some leftover stuff. Hebrews 11:4. See, when you hear this, we've been taught that the reason Cain's sacrifice, his offering, was not accepted by God was disobedience. And that's because we are obsessed with obedience. So everything to us, especially if you came up in this church, everything for us is obey, and don't do this, and don't do that. But I want you to, can I teach this? In the word, there is no command thus far on how to give. There's nothing to disobey or obey. There's no instruction given to Cain and Abel about what to give. This is not about obedience. This is about faith. And the reason Abel's offering is accepted, oh God, I hope you get this, is because when you read it in your Bible, it says he didn't just give the lamb, but he gave the firstborn. With all the fact, meaning it was, it did not wait. He did not wait to give God the runt of the litter. No, the very firstborn, he offered it unto God because he knew if it had not been for God, there would be no lamb. The difference is one prioritized God and the other gave God what was left over. My question to you is, which offering have you been giving God? Oh, we might not shout today. which offering have you been given? Because the Bible says in Hebrews 11:4, by faith, somebody shout faith. Abel offered to God a better sacrifice than Cain. Notice it doesn't say by obedience. By faith, Abel offered to God a better sacrifice than Cain, through which he was attested to be righteous, God testifying about his gifts, and through faith, though he is dead, he still speaks. Woo. Abel's offering was so pleasing to God that God was walking around in heaven talking about it. He's saying, can you see? I didn't have to teach him and he still gave. I didn't have to scare him and he still gave. I didn't have to give him a command, but he just recognized that everything he has comes from me, and he gave out of a heart of thanksgiving. I want to be the kind of giver where God is talking about my gifts. The spiritual principle that underpins all of our giving here at Revision Church Atlanta is this. We don't give just because the Bible says so. We don't give just because we are told to be a cheerful giver. We give because we recognize the God we serve has given us everything. Is there anybody here who's grateful today? Not only did he put money in your account, not only did he give you a job, I'm talking to grateful people, but he not only gave you that, he not only gave you your needs, he also gave you some of your wants and your desires. And if you are grateful for what God has given you, mercy's new morning, he's been long suffering, his mercy endures forever. Oh, you want to thank God today. So now that we understand that, church, I wanna teach you. I told you I'm not gonna necessarily preach. I'm just gonna teach today. It's gonna be different. I wanna now that you understand the reason why we give is not because of commands. It's not because just the Bible says so, even though it does. Our motivating principle for giving is because we serve a giving God. Now, so let's talk about how you give. When you give to the church, I want you to know this. When you give to the church, there are two major ways the Bible talks about, both in the Old Testament and New Testament, that the people of God give to this God who is a giver. So in the Bible, there is what we call tithe. Somebody shout tithe. Tithe is 10% of your income, okay? And in the Bible, the tithe that they would give, they gave as first fruits, offering to God to support the ministry of the temple, the sanctuary. The Levites and priests were paid by it. It helped to fund and finance all of the work that they did in the sanctuary. That's the tithe. It's 10% of what you have. And in the tithing principle in the Bible is that you give the 10% first, that we give the tithe on the top. And so tithe is 10%. That's the biblical principle. But then there's also offering. Somebody shout offering. It's the free will offering. This is what you find more so in the New Testament. Tithe is mentioned only a couple times in the New Testament. But for the most part, in the New Testament, you see offering. Paul talks about it. Jesus talks about it. Jesus even examines the widow as she gives her two mites. The offering is what you give, watch this, above and beyond the 10% that you give God. The principle here was that the church would bring their financial gifts to the community to help finance everything that the early church would do in the preaching of the gospel, in the sharing of the good news, in baptizing and discipling people. That's what the offering allowed them to do. So the biblical principle back then was 10% is the tithe. That's 10% of your income. And then on top of that was offering. Now, here's how we deal with this today. Tithe, when you give tithe to Revision Church Atlanta, the way that this works is Revision Church Atlanta is part of the Seventh-day Adventist denomination. Seventh-day denomination has, and different denominations have different ways that they deal with the 10% that you give. But I want to tell you within the context of our church, this is what we do with the tithe. When you go on revisionchurchatlanta.org and you give your tithe, all of it leaves here. And it goes through the denominational administrative levels to do what? To finance the payment or the salaries of pastors like myself and Pastor Tiffany Brown, to finance teachers in our schools, administrators, and departmental leaders that help to resource the local churches. If you're still with me, shout yes. Now, I want you to do this. I want you to know this. I'm doing some teaching today because I found out as I've been talking to some members and even people who just kind of frequent our worship that we don't really understand how all of this works. And so I want you to understand that when you give tithe, it does not stay here. Not one cent of it stays here. If you indicate whatever amount on the tithe line, it goes to the conference. Now, the conference that we are in, this is a sisterhood of churches. So you have Revision Church Atlanta. You have several other churches in Atlanta that are part of this sisterhood of churches. And we are the Georgia Cumberland Conference of Churches, all right? So when you give, it goes to Georgia Cumberland Conference, all right? Now, I should part here parenthetically to let you know, this means that when you give the tithe, it goes up there. It does not directly go to pay my salary, but it goes to them, and they pay all the pastors, including me. And for the most part, it's kind of standardized what pastors get. So, you know, this is not like other churches where the more you give, the more I make. Lord Jesus, I wish it was, but it's not like that. It's not like that. In fact, I was talking to some people the other day. They didn't know this. Do you know that for the most part, pastors, Seventh-day Adventist pastors, after a few years in ministry, between 8 to 9 years of ministry in the North American area, so in the United States, make the same. No matter how big your church is, right? So if you're pastoring 500 people, right, and yet there's another pastor that's pastoring 30 people, if you've been in ministry the same amount of time, you make the same amount of money. 30, 500. Lord, deliver us. For better or for worse, that is our system. So I want you to know, if you ever see me pull up in a luxury car one day, my dream car, it's not because the church paid for it. It's not because your tithe went to do that. It's because Stephanie bought it. She the one who make the money. That's why I'm praying for the success of your business in Jesus' name. Oh, hallelujah. Y'all think I'm playing. Listen, that's how it works. All right. So tithe doesn't go in the pastor's pockets. Okay, because I don't want to assume that everybody understands the system. We got a lot of new members, a lot of new people. So I want you to understand your tithe leaves here. None of it stays here. All right. And so when you do that, it allows us to be able to facilitate and fund ministry across this country, in Canada and Mexico, and really all around the world. So I want you to know last year what you did in terms of tithe. Last year, we'll put this in the lower thirds, you'll see this. Last year, in terms of tithe that you gave $874,000. You ought to put your hands together and praise God. $874,000 and some change. It was a little bit more than that, but you gave that, and that left here to help fund, again, pastors and teachers, chaplains, administrators, to do work all across this country. That's the tithe. But your offering, somebody shout offering. Your offering is the money that you give that stays here at Revision Church Atlanta. This money is what we use to fund and finance everything the church does in order to further the mission that our church has to reintroduce people to Jesus Christ. When you give, it allows us to do everything that you see, all right? So when you give offering on revisionchurchatlanta.org, most of you do that digitally, virtually. When you do that, it helps to fund ministry, to rent this worship space, serve the community, produce online content, and so much more. Empower our young people, serve our children, engage young adults, and so much more. Not a dime of tithe you give allows us to do that. It's what you give through offering. If you got it, shout yes. Let me tell you what you did last year in terms of your offering that stays here at Revision Church, $858,000. Come on, come on, come on, come on, and bless his name. Come on, bless his name, $858,000 that you gave. And we praise God. Now, some of y'all didn't shout because you don't understand really what that means. Can I help you understand? The average Adventist church, our size, in fact, even bigger, the tithe to offering ratio is usually 65% leaves the local church and goes to the conference so that you can't use that. Most Adventist churches are operating off of what's left. Anywhere between 25 to, at the very most, 35%. I'm not going to call names. I'm talking about the biggest of churches you know. Operate off of 30 to 35. How do I know? I know all the pastors. They're my friends. 30 to 35% of what they're operating on, that's what they have. It's just 30 to 35% is local offering. The reason some folks shouted today is because when you look at the average, you don't have to be a mathematician. I showed you the tithe. I showed you the offering. We're about 45 to 47% of what you give totally stays here. Come on, praise God. You ought to be glad about it. Now, I want to open up the books a little bit, and someone might say, you know, we could do this. We have business meeting tonight at 6, and so we'll answer some questions that perhaps come out of this presentation. But I wanted to, the reason I wasn't going to wait for business meeting to do this is because a whole lot of y'all ain't going to show up. You haven't been showing up to business meeting, so I brought it to you. Amen. I want you to know. No, I think knowledge, to a certain extent, is power. You are empowered when you know. I want you to know when you give that offering, that $858,000 last year, I want you to understand how we are using what you give. This is based on what we're projecting for this year and how we give. So we're going to put up this pie chart. Yeah, I'm going to show y'all a chart because I want you to see it. All right? All right, we'll put that up full screen so they can see this. I'm going to show you what you're, tell you what you're looking at. So I want you to understand that 56.6% of what you give in offering are fixed expenses, and I'll share with you what that means, all right? So that takes care of the expenses in terms of pastoral staff, administrative, all of the rental of this facility, all of that, all of those things kind of come under there. General expense is 1.9%. That's legal fees, banking stuff, all those kind of little things, 1.9%. And then what I'm really excited about is ministry expense is 41.5%. Now, to give you some perspective, a lot of churches, the percentage they have left over for ministry expense is around 20, 25, 30% of their local budget. Our church is so serious about ministry that 41%, that means 41 cents out of every dollar you give goes directly towards ministry, serving the members, and serving your community. We're grateful for that. It means we prioritize, we do everything based on our mission to reintroduce people to Jesus. Now, just to give you a further breakdown, and we won't have a chart for this, but I'll just tell you this. I think we can put in the lower thirds. In our fixed expense, that 56%, I want you to understand what that is. 14.6% of that 56 is goes to your pastoral staff and the expenses to make sure that you have a staff that is paid fairly, that is taking care of their insurance and liability insurance. And I want to tell you why this is important. because when we started, in fact, when I was kind of out of pastoral ministry and I was teaching, took a little hiatus from pastoring to teach at Oakwood, and I thought about coming back to pastor, and I said, well, there's two things that's going to happen. If I pastor again, I'm going to have to plant a church. And number two, if I pastor again, I will not do it alone. Listen, you need to understand. I think we take for granted this, but there are some people here who might understand. We take for granted that most churches in our denomination, there are churches double our size. This is no hyperbole, no exaggeration. Double our size, 1,000 members. I know churches with 1,000 members, one pastor. Yeah, I do think it is crazy. Yeah. Well, one pastor. Now, I'm not going to go into all that a pastor does, but trust me when I tell you, it is not healthy. It is not healthy for a pastor, for a man or a woman, one person to pastor 1,000 Negroes. It ain't healthy. No, it ain't healthy. And it is because not only of the time, but the spiritual, the emotional strain that is placed on a pastor. I mean, y'all don't know. We've never really shared with you. Just the toll that it takes when you're counseling and when you're conversating and coaching and sharing and correcting and encouraging and exhorting and doing all of those things when people have access to you, and not always is it reciprocal, the love and the care. I want you to understand, that's why I said there's no way I'm going to do this by myself. So during the pandemic, let me show you, and I'm telling you this for a reason. The reason I want you to know this is you were so faithful during a pandemic that we hired our first local hire, Pastor Jordan Houston, during the pandemic. And although he is part-time, he has worked overtime and has been a great blessing to this church. Come on, church. We were able to do that. That's not a conference hire. That's local. Your offering helped us to do that. And then as we continue to grow, coming out of the pandemic, we said, you know what? We're about to make this turn coming out of the pandemic. Your giving kept going up. Our numbers were growing. We started gathering again. And as the mission, as God was calling us to even greater, we said, you know what? It's not just the two of us who can help lead this church. We need some sisters. We need to balance this thing because it's just two brothers, but we need the genius, the brilliance, the contribution, come on, of some sisters in ministry to take this thing to a whole nother level. So God brought Pastor Gina and Pastor Tiffany to us, and come on, let's praise God for them. Now let me clarify so that you understand. Your giving did two things. It allowed us to have two local hires. Pastor Gina's local. Your offering pays for her. Pastor Houston, also local. Pastor Tiffany, here's the other side of it. Because you were faithful also in your tithes, the conference office looked at the money that this church was giving and saying, y'all need another pastor. And I just want to give Georgia Cumberland Conference a shout out. Thank God for them, because I'm trying to tell you, not every conference would do that. I'm teaching today. If y'all still with me, shout yes. So that 14% out of that 56%, those fixed expenses, I don't want that to just be some big number and you don't know what it is. That fixed expense of 56 and so percent, 14% of that goes to help with taking care of our local hire pastors, then 18.8% of that goes towards supporting compensation for those who serve you with such excellence, who bring specific skills to what we do. That's our media director, come on, and communications, and our executive assistant, Sequoia, and so many others. There's a few others, we should say. And so we make sure that we take care of them. They don't have salaries, they're stipended. You know there's a difference between the two. But we try to bless them and thank them for what they do. And then 19.6%, want you to lean into this, goes toward rental facilities because we do not have our own space yet. So 19.6 goes towards renting this and office space, which Revision we do have. We have an office space now with Industrious in Midtown. And so we have different places that we have to rent when we have to do seminars and meetings and different things. And so that's what allows you to do all of that. And I want you to understand, again, 41 cents out of every dollar goes directly to ministry. But here's the real good shout. Is that we as a church, I shared with the church maybe now 2.5 years ago, that I want us to not only receive tithes that leave here and go to the conference, I want us to take the offering that we have and tithe part of our, 10% of our offering goes directly to serving our community. Why? Because of Matthew 25, 32 through 40, Jesus talks about how in the judgment, God will separate, as he calls it, the sheep from the goats. And the separation will be that those on the right, he will say, come in those of you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For why, when I was hungry, you gave me food. When I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. And they would say, well, Lord, when did we do that? He said, you did it when you did it unto the least of these. And so I want to tell you real quick that because of your local giving, you gave last year $85,000 directly back to community partnerships that blessed people in the community. Angel Tree that helps children of incarcerated parents, we gave 10,000. Rise Against Hunger, we gave 11,000 to feed people. We fed 10,000 families through that. We bought banned books that they put out of schools so our kids will know the real and total history of our people. We gave $9,000 to Solomon's Temple that helps house those precious women and children who are unhoused. We gave to DeKalb Juvenile Justice System $5,000 to help kids in tutoring and in mentoring programs. We gave $25,000 to Morris Brown College to give seniors who are graduating a debt-free education. $2,000 to voter education, $10,000 to Dream Academy mentorship. We gave $2,500 to the Black Market Foundation, $1,200 to help in feeding those mothers who were struggling to feed their children. But that's not it, church, because you ain't shout like you should. We gave, on top of that $85,000, $55,000 to emergency assistance to not only members of this church, but people in our community who've never come to church and maybe never will. We help to keep their lights on. We help to keep them from being evicted. We help to pay the utility bills. We paid their mortgage and their rent, and we did it through your giving. But can I shout y'all some more? We gave 2 months of BetterHelp counseling, free counseling. We paid up to the tune of $9,000 for 10 people who wanted to get counseling on our tab. Last year, We gave $25,000 in educational scholarships to our members for people going to college and trade schools and academies and private schools. In the last 2 years, you've given $50,000 of educational scholarships. And here's the real thing, we did not limit it to Adventist education. Because we don't believe you should be penalized if God led you to go somewhere else. We want to partner with you wherever God sent you so that you can get your degree. You did that with your giving. You did that with your giving. And so I want you to know, I want you to understand how this works. We give because we serve a giving God. We want you to also know, the reason I'm doing this today is so that we practice transparency so that you can have faith to know that we are faithful stewards of what you are giving. And that we are not spending the lion's share of it on making us comfortable. But we're leveraging our influence on our finances for the kingdom of God. If you love that, say amen. Now, I'm almost through, but I want you to understand this. And here's where I want you to really understand, as much as we have given, here's a data point that really drew my attention. 72% of all that giving that I just told you about that stays local, that $858,000, 72% of all that money came from non-members. Now, let me make some sense of that number, okay? Because there's some reasons why, all right? First reason that 72% of our local giving, our offering, came from non-members is we have a lot of you, both listening to me online and in the building, we have a lot of you, some of you, those who will watch this later this week, a lot of you who think you are members, and you are not. Because you haven't signed up, right? So listen, we understand this, and we praise God for our finance committee who gathered all this information and data for us. We're so grateful for Reverend Dr. Brown, who leads our finance team. We praise God for you and all those of you who serve on the finance team. I want you to understand this. We talked about this. We understand that a lot of y'all think you're members and you're not, all right? So, and you've been giving. And so you think, okay, I'm attending, I'm giving, I might even be serving, that makes me a member, all right? So let me help you. You are operating like a member, okay? You're operating like a member, but we need you to actually be a member. Need you to sign up. You know why? So that we can count you, all right? There's some other reasons, I'll go into that later, but so that we can, you can be counted. See, once those of you who are giving and serving, but you haven't signed up yet, once you do that, this changes this, right? Because now we count you as a member. So we understand. Some of you have been giving, but you just haven't signed up to be a member. All right. Secondly, we have a lot of you who give, but you don't see the benefits of becoming a member. All right. So you give, but you have consciously said, well, I don't need to be a member because I'm doing it anyway. I'm giving. I'm kind of serving. So why should I be a member? So we've talked about this as a leadership team, that we need to do a better job of coming and helping you to understand what are the benefits and expectations you should have of us and what we would expect of you being a member at Revision Church Atlanta, all right? In any case, we're grateful that you are giving. Thirdly, and most exciting to me, is that we have people who are not members of any church who do not give regularly anywhere else, and they believe in Revision's ministry so much that 72% is made up of a lot of people who just said, I believe in what y'all doing, I'm gonna give it to you anyway. We have people who don't go to anybody's church But they say, I believe in what Revision's doing, so I'm going to give. If you're in one of those three categories, we say thank you to all of you, but we also want you to understand you have a place here with us. And we'd love for you to be a member. Now, I know I'm overwhelming you with numbers, so here's the last one. And we don't even have this on the screen. I got this fresh this morning. I was waiting on this information because I wanted to know last year, what was the percentage of our members who gave, and what was the stratification, the categories? I won't share all of them with you, but this is the challenge. If you're ready, shout yes. 43.9% of people who give to Revision, these are members, okay? 43.9% of our membership, these are people who are signed up, official members, 43.9% of members give between $1 to $10 monthly. I knew that would shock you. The numbers are right, we checked them. 43.9% of our members give between $1 to $10 monthly. So then, there may be several reasons, but I want to challenge you with the spiritual principle. Remember, Cain gave what he had in front of him, but the reason it was not accepted was because it was an afterthought. Could it be that the reason that almost 44% of our members only give that amount is because we are not prioritizing the God who gave us everything we have? That's a significant percentage. But there is another reason why. And that is perhaps we need to empower you with understanding what it means to be a believer and how giving is not something that we just do, again, out of obligation or command or reading in the Bible or even because the church needs it, but because you need to give. It's an act of worship to a God who has blessed you with so much. So I want you to hear me. I'm not sharing that data point to make you feel bad. I'm not sharing that to shame you. It's just the truth. And sometimes we have to be faced with the truth so that we can go back and reflect, is what I'm giving to God reflective of how good God's been to me? Now, after some reflection, let me end with some celebration. If 44% of our members at this present time, I'm speaking prophetically because it's going to change after today, 44% of our members give only $1 to $10 per month. Imagine that. We have other stratifications. There are others who are on the list who give 25 to 30 and 50 to 100 and 250 to, and we go all the way up. But the lion's share is in that category. If 44% give $1 to $10 and we do all that we just did, have you put that together? If 44% are only giving that, and there are others in lower, much lower percentages who are giving more, and you put that all together, and if God is able to use a membership where only 44% are giving between $1 to $10, and he is able to do all that we have been doing, we ought to stop and give God praise that he takes the five loaves and the two fishes, he takes our sometimes afterthought offerings. He takes the pennies we put. He takes the little bit we trust him with. And he said, you know what? I'm going to take the little you give me. I'm going to multiply it. And I'm going to share the gospel through the little that you give. So I can tell you right now, I am not dismayed. Because I believe if God has been doing this, do you know we've broken records in this conference? They told us this, that you are the first church in this short amount of time to reach this amount of financial giving. It's only God. And I believe now and throughout the rest of this year, as we equip you, inform you, challenge you, expect of you, and help you to get to the place in your own finances and in your own trusting God to do even better, that 44% is about to be changed. Do you know why? I'm done. Because the Bible says Abel's sacrifice, his offering was accepted because Abel realized that Adam and Eve, his parents, who had been put out of Eden, that the only reason he could be able to have what he had is that a God who, even after we had sinned, after we had messed up, after we would make mistakes, that God would still bless him to be able to have something he would call his own. Abel said, I'm going to give you the first because I don't deserve it. Do you understand? Abel gives a worship. He gives offering to God who could have killed every last one of them. But because of his grace, Abel says, I'm going to give you the first, because if it had not been for you, I would not have anything. His worship was because he saw grace. He wasn't in Eden, but he still had life. They lost paradise, but they didn't lose their lives. And when you realize that what you have is because of the mercies of God, Revision, we about to change that number. We about to change that number. We're grateful for what you have done, but God is calling us to greater works. And I want you to know, I'm not saying this. Notice I haven't even mentioned the building fund yet. I haven't even mentioned. This is not predicated on the fact that we just need y'all to, y'all better give because we got to get this building. No, I believe if the spiritual principle is secure in you, that I give to God because his very nature is that he gives to me. And as a believer, I'm a reflection of his nature. If you get that, we will have everything we need to get our own building. So we're going to put first things first. The principle is we give to a God who's so freely given to us. I want you to stand with me and I want to pray. But I want you to take just a moment, to reflect on how good God has been to you and what God has given to you. I'm serious. I want you to just take a moment and I want you to think about all the things God has given to you, all the people God has placed in your life who love you and who lift you up. I want you to think about all of the ways God has shown you his favor. Take a moment and think about it. And as you think about it, notice I did not tell you if you just give more, you'll get more blessings. No, the Bible says that rain falls on the just and the unjust. So we're not going to tie this to anything, any promise. There's promises about what God gives you. Yes, pressed down, shaking over, running over. I get that. But today, I just want you to understand You serve a giving God. Now that you've thought about what he's given you, I want you, just close your eyes and I want you to think about God. Is the offering, ask God, is the offering I'm giving you acceptable? It's not the amount. Is it intentional? Or is it an afterthought? Is it out of a gratefulness for God's grace? Or is it just something you do? Because if you think about how good God has been to you in giving you, I guarantee you, you will give him more. So I want you, even in this space while I'm praying, to search your heart and let God start changing the reason for your giving. Oh God, right now, I pray over your church, those who are in the building, revisioners who are all over around the world, and those are guests and visitors who are joining us online. God, we are grateful that Abel's offering teaches us that it's really about gratefulness. It's understanding that you have been so giving to us that we want to give to you. Lord, we will not succumb to blame or shame or guilt, obligation or manipulation. God, there are people right now who you're speaking to, you've convicted, and you're telling them you require, you want, you expect more because you've been so good to them. And God, we know we're not paying you back. We could never pay for everything you've done. We know that you don't need our money, but we need to practice this act of gratitude. So Lord, right now, as you're speaking to people whose hearts have been pricked, members who are saying, I want to move up to the next categories. I want to give more because my God keeps giving me more. I pray that you'll seal every decision. And God, right now, yes, Holy Spirit. God, right now, would you please strengthen our faith? Because, Lord, we believe. But when we look at the bills and we look at our responsibilities and we look at tuition and we look at childcare, God, when we look at all those things, God, sometimes we don't know if we can do it. But God, increase our faith and help us to know that the God who gave us the responsibilities is the God who is responsible for meeting them. So God, we transfer our faith from our finances to our faithful God. And we believe you are about to do exceedingly, abundantly, and above that which we could ever ask, dream. And God, it won't just be in money. It won't just be in money. It'll be in peace of mind. It won't just be in money. God, it'll be having the joy that the world doesn't give and the world can't take away. God, we know you're about to do it. We thank you. In Jesus' name, let everybody say amen. If you heard the word of God today, come on, put your hands together. Listen, you may be seated. Today, if you need to give your life to Jesus, I know we talked about finances, I know, but you know, it's not really a hard turn. You know why? Because I really told you about a God who gives. And the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whomsoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And so I want you to understand today that you serve a giving God, a God who gave his Son to die on the cross for your sins, to get up from that grave so that you can have new life in him. And so we'll put on the screen the QR code if you want to make that decision, whether in the building today, or for those of you who are online, just open up your phone, open up your camera apps on your devices. It'll generate that link so that you can be able. You can be able to make your decision today to give your life to Jesus. I mentioned about becoming a member today. That's how you do it. We're going to leave that up for a little bit. And even after church, you can use that QR code and you can join the membership of Revision Church Atlanta. Some of you are giving already. Some of you are serving already. You might as well become an official member of the family. And God will seal every decision made today in His presence. So I want to tell you one last thing as part of our appeal today. We want to make sure we are giving you an opportunity in every way to give. And so today we're starting something new. For those of you who have been giving online, all of our giving, you know that we don't pass the offering plates after the pandemic. We don't do that anymore. You've been giving. But for those of you who come on any given Saturday morning, you got cash to give or you want to write a check. Some of you are saying, I don't deal with all that QR code stuff. I want to write me a good old-fashioned check. Well, we've heard you. And so today, starting today, we've got receptacles to receive your offerings at the three doors. You'll see blue receptacles. They say offering. You also will have these offering envelopes. They should have been in your seats. You can fill those out. You can make out your checks payable to Revision Church Atlanta. We'll also put on the screen, for those of you who usually give, our other ways of giving, revisionchurchatlanta.org. and our PayPal. You can also use the QR code to give. We thank you in any format that you give. But listen, here's how you're going to do this. As Pastor Houston, I believe, is going to come up to give just a few announcements as we get ready to leave, because we have a really important election, voter education, getting you ready for the elections coming up. So we want you to stay after church. We have refreshments. But before you go, we want you to fill this out. If you got cash today that you want to give, you're saying, listen, I want to start my journey as a giver. You might be a guest, a visitor. You're saying, I'm not a member here, but I want to support this ministry and what it's doing to help and serve its community. You can just get a pen, pencil out, fill this out. And the receptacles are right in the back. So when you are getting ready, when we dismiss you, you're going to walk out either the middle aisle or any one of these aisles on the side. You will see the blue receptacle. It says offering on it. Just drop your gift, all right? Put your check, put your cash in here. Please do put your name on that so we can record your gift. Fill out just a few things, your name, address, and your contact information so we can thank you as you continue to give, and then drop that in the receptacle. Is that all right, church? Is that all right, church? I know most of you give online, but for those of you who want to give this way, and for those of you who are guests and visitors, we made this possible so that you can give, and we're grateful for how we will continue to take giving at Revision to the next level. Praise God.
Amen. Can we give God praise because He's generous? Oh, come on, Revision. We can do better than that. Can we give God praise because we serve a big and generous God? Amen, amen. Listen, if you are a member, you want to learn more about this generous God that we serve and how He has impacted our community and moving through our community, we encourage you to take part in our business meeting tonight, B's business meeting tonight at 6 p.m. That information is going to be on the screen. You can go ahead, and we encourage you to sign up for our text messaging system so that you can receive that information to be a part of our business meeting as we continue to share more of the ways in which God is moving through our community. And so again, we encourage you to be a part of that, all of our Revision members. We also want to let everyone know that today, immediately following church, we have a symposium on voting. It's going to be amazing. We have a best special guest speaker who's going to be with us this afternoon, and it's everything we need to know about voting. And so we encourage you to stay behind for this. Listen, we want to let you all know that if you are staying for the symposium, we have food for you. All right, I want to say that one more time. If you are staying for the symposium, we have food for you. But if you have to leave, we understand we got snacks for you on your way out. But if you are staying for the symposium, we have food for you. And so we ask that, hey, if you have to leave, we totally understand. please grab your snacks. But if you have to, let's leave the food for those who are staying for our symposium. Amen? Amen. Let's just stand for closing prayer. Amen. Let us pray. Dear gracious God, we are so grateful today because, Lord, you are generous. And God, we're grateful because we received the word that is to motivate us and encourage us to just be generous in return. And so, God, we pray that as we leave this place, God, that we would keep this word in our hearts. And God, may we share it with someone as well. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you are staying for the symposium, it's going to be right down the hallway in the multi-purpose room. That's where the food will be at as well. Look forward to seeing you in a few minutes. God bless.